is to sort of get into the story a little bit in a general sort of way with some highlight points. And then the rest of the course after that, we will probably make forays into it and then back up and then eventually just go right on through. But I want to set the stage and I want to prepare our minds and get us refamiliarized with the story so that we can, you know, proceed us what the Lord has for us. Genesis chapter 6. And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took unto them wives of all whom they chose. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the land in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bore children to them, the same became mighty men who were of old men of renown. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thought of his heart was only evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and creeping things and fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them. All right. In my younger days, when I would read this, my attention would be drawn strictly to what is all this giant stuff and all these sons of God and what the heck is all that. And there are other classes from many years ago that I shared on what I thought that represented and everything. I don't really want to get into that in this particular course. And again, I dealt very specifically with all that before. But particularly tonight, what I would like to do is just point out a couple of main spiritual points. And the name of this class is Spiritual Realities of Noah, pertaining to Noah. And so I noticed as I was reading this time that the scriptures, you know, God is declaring that you could almost say God is declaring that he's fed up. Now, that's not the case. It's not what's going on, but that's the way we get it. God is fed up. God has seen all this sin and is upset with it, and he's going to do something about it. And that there's just this, all this horrible sin everywhere. But interestingly enough, in this go-round, when I was reading this, I noticed that there was only really one sin mentioned. And we read it in several different verses, and the same thing was mentioned. And I'm going to put it to you like this. The only sin that was really mentioned, and apparently the reason why God said, that's it, I'm wiping this thing out, is because there was a mingling of the seeds. There were sons of God and the earth. Okay? So, I mean, if you just, you know, I mean, we want to get into all the, what are these giants and all, you know, and that's great. That's great fun and everything. But let's also just go to the Lord and find out what's really on the heart of the Lord. And I want you to notice that it didn't say, and God was very angry. It didn't say that God was fed up. In fact, the interesting term that it used was, what is it, verse 6? And it grieved him at his heart. Verse 6, the end of verse 6. And it grieved him at his heart. This is not the sound of a fed up person. This is not the anger of someone who's just had enough and said, I've had it, I'm wiping you all out, I'm going to kill you all. And that's what it sounds like. You know, I think there's a lot of scriptures and a lot of things that sound this way to us because of our carnal mind. For example, when I was sharing in Holland recently, I got into the truth of, I went to the book of Revelation, and I think it's also in Psalm 2 and whatever, where it says, he shall smite them with a rod of iron. And I believe that in some of the context that this is found. It may be some sort of angry thing. But the Spirit of God took me to Gibeah. And the story where, you know, he smote the vessel and broke it, and the earthen vessel became broken so that the light could be seen. And I thought, you know, if God's smiting us at all, it's not just because he's upset, angry, cannot stand us, doesn't want to be around us, and just wants to beat on us. It's because he wants Jesus out of us, and he does it also because you're in agreement with him. You want Jesus out of you. And so, could we maybe, I know it's hot, we close that and turn that fan on right there? I don't even know how you're standing, Carolyn, with your hearing situation. Is that okay, guys? I'm sorry. I just think it would be better for her and for all of us. All right. Yeah. You remember I pointed out the line of Cain? Just kidding, brother. you know, I just thought it was interesting that when it says, and the Lord will come and smite us with a rod of iron, and it says he will break us like potter's vessels. What if we're reading his heart as he is this violent person who's just out to get us, and yet he's writing it saying, I really want Jesus out of you, and I love you enough to answer your prayers by bringing you into brokenness so that his light can be seen through you. You know? And now, back to my point of the way these verses are written compared to the way most people share them, the way that those verses I just talked about are written. What if we tended to read the Bible in light of a carnal mind instead of the mind of Christ? What would be the result? Well, we might see God as a very vengeful God only and not realize his heart behind him. I mean, my God, and it grieved him at his heart is not the kind of phrase that most people would think about God. God's heart is grieved. This is a heart issue with him. You know? That here we were meant to be his. I mean, you know, do you ever think about the term where it says God is a jealous God? Folks, most of the time when I hear people say God is a jealous God, they're talking about an angry God who's mad at us. God's a jealous God and he's going to slap you down. You know? Folks, that today, God would be thrown into jail. You know? But in reality, this stuff hurts. Because these are heart issues. And, you know, why is he so grieved? Consider the reason is because he bears us in the depths of his heart. And that what he formed and what he had in mind at creation and what he was after was something very different than what it turned out. And keeping your place here, but look with me in Jeremiah. I think there's a couple of scriptures in Jeremiah 2 that will maybe help explain this grieving of his heart. Jeremiah 2. There are many other scriptures that could be used, but I feel like this gets more to the reality of what's being communicated in Genesis chapter 6. Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 1. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, go and cry in the hearing of Jerusalem, saying, thus saith the Lord, I remember thee, the kindness of thy youth, the love of thine espousals, when thou wentest after me in the wilderness, in a land that was not sown. Israel was holiness unto the Lord, and the first fruits of his increase. All that devour him shall offend, evil shall come upon them, saith the Lord. Hear ye the word of the Lord, O house of Jacob, and all the families of the house of Israel. Thus saith the Lord, what iniquity have your fathers found in me, that they have gone far from me, and have walked after vanity, and are become vain? neither said they, Where is the Lord who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, who led us through the wilderness, through a land of deserts and of pits, through a land of drought and the shadow of death, through a land that no man passed through, and where no man dwelleth? And I brought you into a plentiful country to eat its fruit and its goodness, but when you enter, you defile my land and made mine inheritance an abomination. All right. What we're getting here from the prophet Jeremiah, who is hearing the word of the Lord, and we know from the New Testament, from Jesus' word, that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So in reality, we're hearing the heart of the Lord. And the Lord is brokenhearted here. He is saying, you know, what did I do to you that you've left me? He said, I remember that. I mean, he's saying to them, I remember the kindness of your youth. I remember the love of your spouses that was towards me. And how you went after me, even though you went into the wilderness in a land that was not sown, you went after me into the hard place. You didn't care about the place. You cared about being with me. And so there is this this thing where he's appealing to them, and then he has to say, you know, the truth. What iniquity have your fathers found in me that they've left me? They walk in vanity. All right. Comparing this and connecting this with Noah's situation. Just shortly before this, you know, 10 generations from Seth, God made a good land and brought us in. What he brought into it was not what ended up in it. You understand what I'm saying? I think that's an important point. What he brought into it was not what ended up in it. The Adam that he made is not the Adam that ended up being kicked out of the garden. I think that's really, really something very, very important for us to realize. That there was, by virtue of this mingling, like this, we no longer were really what he had intentioned and what he made originally. We had become, can I say it, maybe a hybrid? A mixture of several different seeds, I always remember us. I don't always remember. The Holy Spirit tends to bring to my remembrance these junctures, the story of the kings. And if you read it, you know, in some books, it'll start going through all the kings of Israel and say, and so-and-so, king so-and-so, he was born and he served God and he was with Judah. And then, of course, that's Abel and the line of Christ and all of that. And then it'll name those who were of Israel, the kings of Israel, because there was a divided kingdom, those who served the Lord and those who didn't. And then talk about so-and-so. And some of them it'll say, and he was king for 47 years, and he did evil in the sight of the Lord, right? But sometimes it says he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, and he built high places where they worshiped other gods and stuff like that. It's a mixture. And it's like, that's weird, you know. He was a good king and he did this and that, but he allowed idol worship in Bashan, that some city of the beach. And you see this mingling and this changing of the original form. And the joining of two different things that is clearly not what God wanted, but it has elements of it. Elements of it. Could that bring about deception? you be deceived by perceiving, well, that's the Lord. I mean, I've met people, I go, well, that's the Lord. But you know what? Boy, they're really off here. And folks, we're not talking about what you did right there with the Lord when you prayed for that little child. But when you went over here and sinned, that wasn't the Lord. We're not talking about that, folks. All of sin comes short of the glory of God. You're going to find frailty and fault in anybody that you examine close enough. I'm talking about what is the Lord and what clearly is a violation of the very nature and constitution that is Christ. That's an abomination. Well, you get pictures of that, like with Jeroboam, who I think was Ahab. He joined with Ahab to fight against Syria or something. And you're just going, what the heck are you thinking? Or what was Jehoshaphat? Thank you. I knew it wasn't right just at that moment. But Jehoshaphat, you're going, he's a godly king. Everything he's ever done is good. He's a real man of God. What are you thinking joining with Ahab, one of the worst guys that there ever was? And, you know, him and Israel do end up suffering because of some of that stuff. But there is that thing that, you know, we can start mixing in with the very thing that is the opposite of Christ. Man, I mean, I will forgive you if you sin. If you come to me and you tell me anything, and trust me, I've been told everything, I will forgive you, and I will see to it that this church blesses you and loves you. It really, on that scope, it doesn't matter. And I know that most people are afraid that the church and the pastor are going to find out and all this stuff, and there's mortal fear that someone's going to find out that you're not perfect. Well, I already know. And so does God. It doesn't matter. If you have a heart after God, God will forgive you of your sin, get you back on the trail, and bring forth more of the Son. But when you start moving into a territory that is, can I say it like this, anti-Christ? Abomination. And if you start mixing those two, and I've seen that. I mean, I see somebody just stray off over there in that system. But I've seen some that have actually mixed the two. And they still preach Christ, but their life and their nature is all contrary to Christ. It's just, it is an abomination. And so, but God's not just, you know, he's not looking at that and still just going, you're an abomination. He's looking at what he intended you to be. His plans. Part of the reason why we get paralyzed or we don't go forward, it's only one thing. We do not see his heart and his plan and his destiny for our lives. We do not see his plan in Christ and his literal plan that will guide your life and use you in the manner that he wants. We don't see any of that. We tend to look at what's wrong with us and it paralyzes us and we say, God can never use me. Okay. The very fact, and we can go back to Genesis now, Genesis 6, but the very fact that God was grieved in his heart, not angry in his mind, shows that he's ready to keep you with him close and to keep you moving with him. What was that? Mallory's just reaffirming from scriptures for those who couldn't hear this on this tape or whatever, that the scriptures say that God was vexed with them, and the word vexed is not angry or mad and, you know, ready to strike them dead. It was that he was grieved with them, no matter how bad they got off and whatever. And here's why, and here's what we don't understand about God. He has a vision of you, a picture of you, an understanding of you, a reality of you in Christ that's already settled in his heart. Whether you're there, whether you're living to that level or not, doesn't matter to him. As far as he's concerned, Jesus is at his right hand sitting down, it's done. He's not freaking out that you're not going to make it. The only reason why anyone would not make it would not be for lack of provision, it would be unbelief. That he has done this, Jesus sat down, and he's with you. And, you know, encouraging you, saying, look, I'm, you know, who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? Is it God who, you know, did this? Is it Jesus who died, yea, rose again so that you'd be resurrected in him? Are they going to be, is that who's laying at your, no. You know, and so, because we don't know that heart, we grieve that heart. There is an eternal plan that everyone is not involved in, though they could be. The only thing that keeps you from it is not acknowledging the line of Abel, the line of Christ, the lineage of Christ, and stepping into your place, taking your position as a son of God and saying, here I am accepted, I stand here in Christ, and I take my place as a son of God as you see me, and I say yes, and then you go from there, and he backs up his word with signs following. But if we stand over here outside of Christ and we keep trying to see him do it to us, there's no hope for us. Because he didn't do it to us. He did it to us in Christ. And we have all things by Christ, and by union with Christ. So his heart, he embraces, you know, I've often said there's always hope until you're dead. So I've seen people in terrible condition. I'll be honest with you, there are people that I am aware of right now that spiritually, in my mind, they are in a terrible, ugly, bad, terrible position. And yet, my heart and mind and spirit have not changed one iota towards them, and I pray for them like I was their daddy or something. Like the only person left on the planet that would love them. That's the way I pray for them. And I do that by Christ. It's not me. I know it's not me. I don't claim it's me. I know what I am like apart from that, but I'm telling you that it's Jesus. And I can do that. See, you can do this thing. You break out into stuff that's not you when you take that place and believe it long enough, it starts manifesting. So, you know, instead of getting down on yourself when you fail, don't get down, get in. Get in Christ. Put your understanding, and we always say that around here, what does that mean? It means that you, when you say, I'm in, you're saying, God acknowledges me in Christ, and I am accepted in the Beloved, I'm complete in him right now, even though I'm not acting like it, don't manifest it, you're agreeing with him, and you get up, and you quit walking around with your arms hanging down, you know? Does that make sense? This is the heart of the Lord for us. What things can we do by Christ? Well, way more than just being a saved Christian that's just sort of living for God, you know. No, my God, we are eternal beings now with all the resources of the head that can flow through us. We can do, you know, I mean, somebody might, let's just take a real foolish, just incredibly humorous situation. Somebody might look at me and say, oh, I could never, you know, preach like him or see the things he sees or do the things he does. I'm saying incredibly humorous because in my mind, I'm, you know, honestly, when someone ever says to me, you know, wow, you know, you're a son of God, something like that. My immediate thought is, yes, I am, because God declared it so, but I'm probably the worst son of God there ever was, you know. I mean, I don't think more highly of myself than I ought. But I do believe the Lord. I'm sorry. I'm not going to back up on what Jesus has said. said and what he's done when he sat down and denied all that is true, and I'm seated with him in heavenly places, and then start denying that, I'd rather deny me. I'd rather deny my flesh than deny his spirit. And so, you know, we would do that. But I'm telling you that the resources of Christ, not because you're called to be an apostle or a prophet or any of the office things, there's something higher, folks, than offices. There's something more eternal. An office, folks, is for a time period, you know, but there's something from eternity past, and it's because I say that because it's eternal, and that is your office of prophet. You're not going to need a prophet. And abundantly above everything you could ask or think, according to the power that works in you, which is the Son. Okay, so we hold ourselves down and we hold ourselves back constantly in a very limited thing based solely on us and our way of thinking, usually based on our failures and our own personal weaknesses, which has nothing to do with the resources of God. And we don't say, I, you know, it may never happen, but I think I'm going to believe that the Lord is going to start breaking the Word of God open to me. I'm going to see things that I just never could have believed I would see, and that God is going to somehow, like he did with Moses. Moses said, well, you know, don't send me. I can't talk. God said, I'll be with you. Well, he said, don't send me, and he said, I'll be with you. He said, well, I can't talk, and he said, I'll be in your mouth. I mean, his answer in every case was me. It's going to be me. I'll be with you. I'll be in you. I'll talk. I'll do it all. Shut up. But we're so limited. And we do that limitation thing not because we've got the mind of Christ and we see the whole view of the Lord and we say, yes, yes, flow through me to the highest ability that you want to, because I want to see your glory in the earth, and I could be an icebreaker that breaks through frozen tundra of religion that has been set for years and smash it to pieces in some place that you would want me to do, or in all around the world, or, you know, and just come in there and just start tearing up what nobody else could do. But you didn't do it. It was Christ. But we're too, you know, well, I couldn't do that. I'm just a housewife. I'm young, you know. God said to Jeremiah, don't say to me you're young. And you know what he said to him? I'm young. He said, go to them and talk to them. He said, I'm young and I'm scared of their faces. He said, don't look at their faces. You know, you have to. You go to them and you say, look, thus saith the Lord. Some of the kings were really young. And they, like Josiah, was really young. My Lord, how he was used. Well, that Josiah was a shadow Josiah. You are the real Josiah. I mean, you could be. I mean, you're supposed to be. That was shadow land. This is the truth. This is where the Lord comes forth. This is where he lives in the real reality. And not in shadow land anymore. We go, oh, I wish I could be like them. No. Be like Jesus and trust his life. He lives in you. He can do all things. You know, that's scripture. I can do all things through Christ. And there is that reality. I mean, you can abound. I mean, most people say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And they're really talking about, really dumb things that are in the earth and that have nothing to do with what God's talking about. He's saying you can learn to do exceedingly abounding by me, and you can learn to be cut back and reduced and still be with me, like Paul thrown into prison, and still be with me and still be effective. Folks, abasing or abounding does not cut out effectiveness. Paul spent most of his life in prison. Most of these people, look at Joseph, a lot of his life was very limited, and yet it's still the Lord. And there are good examples of people like Paul that by being abased, they were still effective for the Lord. And so, I'm just saying all this because of the heart of the Lord. Because his heart was grieved, and it just kills me to read that it grieved him at his heart. Oh, it just kills me to see this, and it makes me want to break with any mingling at all so that Christ may be all and in all. And let me just tell you, anybody that God has used wasn't because they said, I'm Braveheart, and you're not. It's because they said, since the New Testament, it's because they said, I will step into the position where all the power flows, where all the life and resources come. I will consider myself in Christ and believe beyond my own abilities and put myself in places beyond my own abilities so that I can prove this gospel, not just preach. And so God opens, without faith it's impossible to please him, but God, with faith, he opens the doors. Mountains begin to be moved, and yet you're like Enosh. You are mortal. But all of a sudden, men began to call upon the name of the Lord again. Because now they're not trusting in themselves. They're not trusting in their calling or lack of. I haven't said this in a lot of years. I used to say it a lot when Mallory and Kelly and some of them were in Bible school, which has been how many years now? Seemed like a long time ago. My God, it's been 18 years ago? Oh, man. Anyway, I'm going to tell you something that's going to freak you out. I don't believe God ever called me to the ministry. I don't remember any calling. I know that sounds crazy. I don't remember. I just kept thinking, somebody needs to stand up for the Lord. That's all I ever remember. I remember somebody needs to do this, you know? And then when I got to Bible school, they'd say, well, we need somebody to go over here and do this, or go to the prison and go preach, or go da-da-da-da. And I'd say, well, somebody, you know, and nobody raised their hand. Oh, I'm not ready. I'm not this and that. And I go, somebody's got to go. I mean, and I believe that the Lord is there, and if I make a fool of myself, then I will declare to those people, I am a fool for Christ. I am totally an idiot and unable to do this. But if he does come forth, then I'll say, don't look at me. I'm a fool for Christ and a total idiot. Oh, I'm still saying the same thing, aren't I? I'm Enosh. But I have a treasure. And I just kept getting put in situations and put over here. I mean, even the mission field, when I became a missionary for several years, they came to me before I graduated. And several of the leaders, and they said, well, we've been praying, and we think that as soon as you graduate, I know you and Debbie are going to get married, and we'd like to send you as missionaries to Jamaica. I'm going, I don't even know what I just learned. You know what I mean? I mean, I've sat in classes, but I doubt half of it. One-third, a tenth? Not even a tenth of it is in me yet. I just heard people talk. I can't do it. And they said, don't worry, you'll be going, but just pray about it. So I went and told Deb. I said, they want us to go to the mission field right after we get married. Well, how soon after? Well, they're going to give us 3 months to raise money for our own trip. And we're going to have to raise enough money to go. So we prayed, and the Lord said, go. But I didn't feel a call to Jamaica or the Dominicans. I felt the life of Christ. Honestly, I'm telling you, I didn't feel anything other than Jesus in there going, come on, let me live, okay? Come on, give me a chance. I bet I can do something. You know? And I'm going, okay, I mean, you know, you're going to be putting me in a bad situation, putting me on the mission field, a little island that you can't get off of if you go crazy. You know, you'd be surprised that factor. You get put on an island and when you have a rough day, and there is no McDonald's you can run down to or nothing else, you know. And you'd be surprised what being on a little bitty island will do to you. It'll make you either crazy or form you in the image of Christ. Anyway, just got in those situations, and the Lord just kept moving and kept coming forth, and he would do it, and I would know it wasn't me. And people would say, you know, I mean, I have people that say, and people that respect me and that actually invite me to their country to minister, and they say, you minister as an apostle. I would never say I'm an apostle. I would never even consider being an apostle. If everybody thought I was an apostle, I could never, there is nothing in me that could even, I would rather say I'm a son of God, Christ is my life, and I'm not doing this based on an office for now. I'm just trying to release the eternal Christ and get people to the eternal reality of what this is about. Now, if I can do that, why couldn't the Josiah of today do that? I get amen from Josiah. And so, but I noticed this thing that he must bear us so deep in his heart to be grieved that deep. And I just went, oh. And see, Noah was that way because he saw that. But Noah wasn't one that was grieving God, but he saw that God was grieved. And again, it shocked me to realize that it didn't really get into any specific sin except that one. Isn't that sort of an amazing thing? I mean, because you know how our mind builds. I mean, in my mind, once I saw that, I said, I've got to read back through this and see if this is correct. I read back through it, and I'm looking for, and people were blasphemous, and people were killing one another, and people, you know what I mean? I mean, I really thought it would kind of say that, and it didn't. I mean, it did say every thought of their imagination, all that was, but it didn't go into anything specific except there was a mingling. It shocked me. The Word of God continually surprises me. And it surprises me that after this many years and one who searches the scriptures carefully, that I'm still surprised over and over. Then folks, wherever you're at in the Lord, I'm telling you, you need to kick it up another gear. Kick it up another gear. Because the Lord wants and needs sons of God. Of course, this isn't talking about male volunteers. Talking about sons in the image of Christ, that's male and female, just like the bride is made up of male and female. It is not a gender thing. It is a spiritual place. You are a son of God by Christ. Christ is that son in you and is your sonship. That's why when he's revealed in you, the spirit of the Son, not the spirit of Almighty God or the spirit of the Christ, the Messiah, the spirit of the Son comes into your heart and cries, Father, Father. He doesn't cry, save, save. That's already happened. That's way earlier. You are a son of God, and God's trusting in his sons to carry on his work. You know, Father and Son. Father and sons. But we keep denying our place as sons. We keep saying, I'm not called to this, or I can't do that, or I'm too weak, or I'm this and that. Well, you're all of that. You're weak, and you're probably not called to be a, you know. I mean, for example, I think of somebody like, maybe this isn't a good example, and I'm thinking of Mother Teresa. Now, I know Kelly probably talks a lot about her. Did she mention recently? Good. I think of Mother Teresa, and I doubt very seriously that she was an apostle. She was a prophet or a pastor or a teacher. What the heck was she? Oh, she was just a big, big, fat gift of helps. I don't believe it. I mean, you know, I don't believe it. I believe she was a son of God. I do. She laid down her life. She gave up her rights. She lived for God and others. She did it joyfully. That sounds like the son to me and her. You understand what I'm saying? Well, you know, what if she said, well, I'm just a girl. I'm just an Irish girl. I think she was Irish, originally. Kelly would know, but she's not in the room when I first met her. You know, I'm just an Irish lass. I'm a lass. And so I can't do it. I'm not able. She didn't say that. She said, oh, my God, you know, my God is a big God, and he can do through me whatever he wants to do. And kings and great men around the world came and visited her and honored her. And then, you know, and she's in the latter years of her life. I mean, you know, she took care of orphans. She lived in a leper colony with lepers washing their wounds and stuff like that. And people would just come and go, oh, my God, I feel I'm in the presence of greatness. And this is, there's a nice comfortable place in over there for you to rest, you know. And I must, you know, be about my father's business now. And, you know, and they're just going, I'm in the presence of greatness. I thought you were greatness. No, you've got a title. Let me tell you, you're not. A title does not make you great. Greatness makes you great. This son is great. Anybody ever saying, great is the Lord? Well, that's your life. That's the one whose abilities you're supposed to be depending on instead of, I'm just so-and-so. No, you're not. You know, I remember when I was in Bible school and someone was preaching and they said, they were sounding something like what I'm saying right now, and they said, Jesus didn't do that. Jesus laid down his life. Jesus went the extra mile. Jesus did all this stuff. And I remember saying in my mind, yeah, but he was the Son of God. And the Holy Spirit said to me, well, who do you think you are? You know? And I went, oh, yeah, I'm the Son of God. You know, we are sons of God. Who do you think you are? And I went, oh, yeah. And I remembered that my sonship, I was a son of God by Christ. So the same one who was doing that then can do it now. Oh, no, no. We're too limited by us. We're too limited by what we see. We're too limited by what we feel. And so we mingle it and we water it down. And we get it to such a place that we're paralyzed and we can't do anything. Or we do very little, you know. Let me tell you, if you start stepping up because of your pride or because of your desire for ambition and office and power and prestige, don't do it. Sit down, shut up. Sorry, I used the word shut up. But Christ is able in you and you are not, then let Jesus step up, and you know you're not doing it to glorify yourself, but by the power of an endless life, let Jesus come out of you. Don't be afraid. But you got it. The difference is your motive. Is this me or is it the Lord? And most of the time, it's a mixture. So here's what you do. Here's how you deal with the mixture. Well, I want to do this for what it'll bring to me, but the Lord wants to do it because it's his nature to lay down his life. So I'm going to do it not because of me, and I'm going to do it not for pride and not for my ambitions. I'm going to do it because of you, Jesus. And then you step into it, and you stick with the Lord through it. Even if every once in a while your flesh goes, ooh, you say, shut up, we're not doing this for you. Is that possible? But we're so afraid, you know, around here we preach the Lamb, so I'm so afraid somebody will think it's not the Lamb. Between after the conference and up to the New Year's Eve service to press home some things about the truth about the Lamb instead of our concepts of the Lamb. May the Lord grant it. All right. So then the Lord is saying, basically, you know, not that long ago, you know, a little more than 10 generations, I made all this beautiful place, this beautiful earth, this untouched, unpolluted, uncorrupted place, and it didn't take you very long at all to mess everything up. And along that line, I mean, sometimes I get on a roll like this, so I'll just follow it out. I don't know if you've noticed the movies that are coming out and what's on TV. But just about everything is about the end and the destruction and judgment and, you know. I mean, everything, let's see if I can remember some of them. Sarah Connor Chronicles. What is it? Heroes. There was one on, it was called the 4400. On and on and on and on. There's all these, and they're popular now. And they're popular because when you go to movies, I mean, there was Cloverfield and I Am Legend and, you know, I mean, on and on. Again, it's, you know, all these things about the end. You know, wonder what's going on. Wonder why there's this affinity for all that. Interesting that that's what all is going on right now, and that's what people want to watch. And of course, part of it is they want to watch it because, like Heroes, they're hoping that somebody will do something to fix this thing. And it does appeal to just about everybody. They would like to be one of those people with abilities that save the, you know, earth. Well, I want to tell you, you have abilities. They are supernatural. They are not what you were born with, but they have developed since being born again. Those abilities are Christ in you and all of what he has. That being said, so the Lord is saying, I'm going to, you know, about, does anybody know how much time I got left? Because I really don't know. And I, three more? Yeah. Well, I think 15. Okay. Why is he taking away this lush of land, this beauty of waterfalls, and this great earth? Why is he taking that away from us after having given it to us? Well, my conclusion after the mingling is that we have changed. Like in Jeremiah, where are the espousals of your heart? Where is that? We've changed. We don't even know it. We think God owes us all that because he promised it to us. But he promised it to someone else, if you understand what I mean. Not that one, but the one that was. And the one that was in his heart. And that's why his heart's grieved, because he doesn't have the one that was in his heart. And that's why I have no desire, you know, to take what I was going to give to my beautiful bride and give it to a sea hag. Or a dragon lady. Who drove a dragon wagon. Anyway, that's enough. Not his heart's desire. He's going, where is she? What happened? My God, you know? You are not her. He's not, he's not, shall I say it and get in trouble, he's not an Indian giver. He's not going to give to the Indians and then take it away. We'll put it like that, because that's true. Truth. He is not going to do that. He's going to give to her, and then if she's not there anymore, she's going to take that, all that beauty and power and everything away from this one, this creature, because they will just use it for their own flesh, and they will use it to rend one another. And so he's going to remove it. There's no hope for all this flesh. So in one sense, you could say, we are no longer the ones he gave it to. We are no longer the ones that he gave it to. All right, and then just verse 8, after all that we just read. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And I mentioned this at the orientation, that it does say in verse 9, and I'll address that in a second. It says in verse 9, these are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man and perfect in his generations, and Noah walked with God. Okay, my God, he's a just man, he's perfect in his generations, and he walks with God, but he gets on the boat because he's found grace. Sorry for being so crude with the word, but I'm saying he's allowed on the boat not because he's just, not because he's perfect, and not because he walks with God. He is allowed on there because he found grace, and he didn't find it lying on the ground. You can look on the ground, you can look in your job, you can look in your locker, or you can look in your cubicle or your bedroom, or you are not going to find grace. You're going to have to start looking into his face. I know it probably didn't happen this way. Maybe it did, because in some ways something similar happened with me. Noah's standing there and he's finished, because he walked with God just like Enoch did. He's been looking at the Lord's face for a long time. He's been looking and just looking, because he's examining his heart, because you see his reaction. You know what I'm saying. I mean, you say something and you see somebody flinch like they're hurt. You go, if you love that person, you go, what did I say that caused that hurt? You understand what I'm saying? And so you're connecting his face with the reaction, and you want to find the source of that. Well, so you spend a long time doing that with the Lord. You're discovering things. You're hearing things. You're looking, you know, I'm going to say it like this. You're looking deeper as time goes on. And it's almost like you're looking, you know, and you're looking into his face, you're looking into his eyes, and all of a sudden you go, hey, what's that in the corner of your eye there? I think I discovered grace. I think I see in you, coming out of you, grace. You're not so bad after all. You really, that grace is coming from your heart. Now, what did Paul say? I do not make void the grace of God. Anybody ever heard that scripture? I do not make void the grace of God. One I used to quote a lot many moons ago. And a few suns ago. They who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. Did you hear what it said? I mean, that's if you really want to know what scripture is. It's Romans 5:17. It's not saying that only special people get this. It says if you are one of those who will receive an abundance of grace, you're going to reign in life by this one, this Son, Jesus Christ. But your requirement is you have to receive. See, the scriptures don't just say believe. They say believe and receive. Believe and receive. And so, you know, the example I use, let's see if I do it here. I haven't used that one in a while either, but it's always a good one. The example that I use, can you turn that a little with me? I don't know, everybody's, I need to come over here to Josiah and use an example here. And that is, here, hand me this Bible, but wait just a second. I use this example with people in relationship to receiving the Holy Spirit, but it works with everything. And that is, you do not just believe, you receive. But some people would say, you know, give me the Holy Spirit. So let's act like the Bible there represents the Holy Spirit, or it represents all the abilities of the Lord through us, or, you see what I'm saying? So please give me the Holy Spirit. Please give me the Holy Spirit. Oh, I believe you want to give me the Holy Spirit. Please, why? Give me the Holy Spirit. Why won't you give me the Holy Spirit? Okay, that's believing he wants to, but there's one thing that most people leave out. They don't go, thank you very much. I got it. And walk off and receive it. And that is so, so common with people, is that they believe facts, they believe stuff, but why doesn't it work for them? Why doesn't it come to them? And it's very simple. They don't receive and take it and say, I receive it and believe it and act as if it were true. I'm a son of God by Christ. I'm already in Christ. I'm already accepted in the Beloved. I'm already complete in Him. God will work out the rest of this as far as, that's why the Holy Spirit was sent here. He'll line our outward with our inward. That's his job, and we keep trying to do the work of the Holy Spirit. No wonder we don't have any success. It's like firing the Holy Spirit and us taking over as general manager of our life. Good luck with that one. There, now you've got a problem. All right, so Noah found it. We're running out of time now. I'm going to just say, God didn't force it on him and didn't go, look over here. Meaning, we keep waiting for God to do something so that all of our life will be changed. Am I right or wrong, folks? Come on, we keep working. Well, I believe that I'm waiting patiently. How many years has it been? Well, two, okay? I'll check back with you later. I'm still waiting for it. How many years has it been? 10. Okay, well, I'll check back. Nothing happened yet. See, we're not receiving it. We're not finding it. Finding it for ourselves. Finding it to be true. Finding it and laying a hold of it and saying, shall I be so bold? We are this generation's Noah. We are of that line and that lineage of Abel for this time and for this generation. We're going to wait around and let everybody else do it, and nobody else is going to do it. You know what I mean? Because we're the ones called. You know? But we look at ourselves as a ragtag bunch of people just like Jesus' group who followed him and says, man, we don't measure up to Jesus at all. We're a mess. We're fighting. We're arguing. Am I right or wrong? I mean, surely they didn't go, well, we are the ones, baby. I know one guy did, and that was Peter. You know. And he had to be brought to know it is you. It's kind of like this thing where, you know, I was talking with somebody and they had some demonic problems, and sometimes I had a hard time getting past the devil to them. And I said, you know, you have the victory. You have, and I said, no, not you. You. You know, no, not you, devil. I'm talking to the guy in there, not to, you know. And, you know, that's the deal. You do. You have to take it up. You have to believe the Lord by oneness that these things are yours. And quit being just a small person in a small town in an incredibly small Bible school or church. Be the Son of God. And it means this. Be the vessel, the vehicle of the Son of God to the world. And believe it now. And don't resign yourself to less. All right, let's pray. Father, we just ask you to brand these things in our spirit and in our consciousness and in our being and in our reality, whatever term we want to use, so that we are not bound by the limitations of time and space or of the flesh. But we have the fullness of your life, ready, willing, and able to show yourself through us as branches. Father, let each one that is here break out of the slumber of small thinking. Move into the wide spaces of Christ in us.